Hello, and welcome to the Dark Matter Knits podcast. I'm Elizabeth Green Musselman. It's August 8th, 2014, and this is episode 13. And our theme this week is going to be yarn over, and I'll get to in a minute what we're going to talk about today, what that theme entails, I guess. And but first, I'm going to talk a little bit about what I've been working on, and then we'll get to this theme of yarn over. I mean, basically the idea that I want to talk about today is I was thinking about what yarn overs are, that they're one of two things. Either it's something intentionally you've put into your knitting because you're doing lace, and so you mean it to be there and it looks really beautiful, or it's a mistake you've made, either because you're a beginner knitter and you don't know that when you put the yarn to the back, you shouldn't throw it over the top of the needle. Or it's something that you've just done because you made a mistake. You're not paying attention. I do this all the time when I'm working on DPNs or magic loop. I'll get the yarn kind of wrapped around the needle when I'm switching from one needle to the other or one side to the other. Perhaps you do this too. I mean, I'm calling it yarn over just because it's kind of about that fine line between, or what I want to talk about today is kind of that fine line between what's a mistake and what's actually a good, something that we mean to happen or that it's kind of a good learning experience. So let's start with what I've been working on. I am wearing a finished object. I'm trying out a new camera arrangement this week. I'm actually filming on my iPhone instead of on my computer, so I'm hoping that the video quality comes out a little better, but I'm kind of in a weird angle here. But this is my Enchanted Shrug, which I've been working on since actually October of 2013. It's got a really pretty... When I blocked it, as with all lace, it just opened right up into this lovely thing. I was worried the yarn was going to be a little too crepey and that it was going to just want to smoosh right back in onto itself and not hold its nice lace shape, but that hasn't proved to be the case. I mean, it's bounced back a little bit, but not that much. So basically, it's just a long lace rectangle that, very long, that you just kind of sew up a seam here and then one on the other side, and you leave the back open so that it forms a shrug. I mean, it's kind of the classic simple shrug shape, and I really like how it fits. I mean, I guess my one thing that is not my favorite, and this is not any issue with the pattern, it's just I don't know how it looks on me, but the back isn't really long enough, and that's just a feature of it being a simple rectangle. I mean, I wouldn't want this to be too much floppier than that. I actually kind of like the bell sleeve, but that's about as much as I can tolerate. And if I made the rectangle any wider, if it was just a straight rectangle, if I made it any wider to cover more of my back, then the sleeve would be longer. Now, this is why a lot of shrugs have more shaping on the back. So, lesson learned. I did make a number of modifications, mainly to width and length. I'm fairly tall, and also, you know, a little bigger than most people. So I knew that the one size fits, whenever I see one size fits all in a women's pattern, I'm like, yeah, I don't think so. Not me. I have to buy men's socks for that reason too. You know, I wear a size 10 shoe and, you know, most women's socks are made for like size 7. I didn't change the instructions. I just blocked the snot out of this thing. And, you know, really stretched it out. So it was, I think, in the end was 70 inches long and 15 inches wide or something like that. And that worked just fine. So this is the Enchanted Shrug by Grace McEwen. I've mentioned that before. Made with Pandia's Jewels Wispy yarn, which is a lace weight. And, yeah, I think you could just make it to basically the right gauge and then just block it to whatever size you want. And a little tip, actually, that I figured out that worked really well when I was blocking my shawl was I was trying to figure out, how long should I make mine? Because the one size fits all thing never works for me. So she had a length to block it to, and I knew that probably wasn't going to be long enough for me. So what I did was I took a tape measure. I held it in this hand. It's probably be easier to do with another person. I didn't do it that way. But I held it in this hand, kind of ran it over my slightly bent elbow, across my back, over slightly bent elbow, and back to the wrist again, and used that as the basis for how long to make it. I really like this is a nice piece to have. I wear it, as you do, to go play role-playing games with my son. He and I play this game called Heroes of Rokugan. It's based on the card game Legend of the Five Rings. It's a medieval, it's a kind of like Dungeons and Dragons, but with medieval samurai. It's awesome. I love it. And now you know what a turbo dork I am. But my son, who's now 10, he just turned 10, and I go play, and yeah, it's super fun. So I put this in my bag because the shop where we play, Dragon's Lair, is super cold in the room where we play. So this is a nice thing to kind of throw over. Even though it's 100 degrees outside, it's freezing in there. So that's what I finished. I actually also finished something else, but I can't show it to you yet because the pattern hasn't been released. It was a pattern that I tech edited for the lovely Anne at Little Skein in the Big Wool, and I will show you when the pattern is out. I just wanted to knit it because it looked nice. But I have also been working on one other thing. No spinning. I'll get back to it. But I've been working on this. What is that, you say? Well, I'll tell you. It is a pair of socks that are, I'm working them two at a time, which I've never done before, about which more in a moment. The yarn I'm using is called Fliegende Untertasse. Who took German in high school and college? I lived in Germany for 6 years. Fliegende Untertasse from Schoppenwolle. What that means is flying saucer. Oh, by the way, this drives me crazy. Not because I'm being critical of anybody, but just because I speak German. Oh my God, why am I forgetting the name of this yarn? The German yarn that everybody loves to Wollmeise. It's pronounced Wollmeise. V-Wollmeise. Just wanted you to Sorry. Now you know. The more you know. Okay, so Fliegende Untertasse, it means flying saucer, and it is this cool little cake of yarn that is all dyed at once. And here, check it out inside. So you can see it's like it has this it kind of has the same repeat around and around. And what you might have noticed is that it has two strands coming off. So the whole way this is designed is so that you can do two socks at once. Now, I've never done two socks at once before. I had read a book a couple of years ago by Melissa Morgan Oakes. I think it's just called Two at a Time Socks. And she explains very clearly how to do it. And I realized in reading through it, oh, this isn't that hard. So I tried it. Of course, this is based on my memory of reading this book 2 years ago. So I did okay. The cast on, I decided to do these cuff down, just because I hadn't done cuff down in a while. The cast on was tricky only because trying to keep all the stitches untwisted and all the yarn managed when I first got started was just a little bit. I had to do it a couple of times to kind of get that to work. But once I got it going, then it was super easy. The next part that was a little tricky was figuring out. I did a traditional heel flap, again, just because I hadn't done it in a while. And because I've been doing toe-up socks with afterthought heels a lot in the last few years. So I did the heel flaps back and forth, and then it was a little bit tricky to figure out, okay, now how do I get everything going back in the round again on Magic Loop with two socks at once? But I finally figured it out. It's not really worth trying to explain it here because it would take me a really long time and I would probably just confuse you, but if you want to try it, check out Melissa Morgan Oakes's book, Two at a Time Socks. And I'm going to write down, I don't think I put that in my show notes, so I'm going to write down that I need to add that. What else do I want to tell you about this? This is a fingering weight yarn, very, in that kind of standard sturdy German sock yarn vein, the kind of thing that will outlast nuclear war. I mean, they're perfectly soft. It's just not merino, and it's got some nylon in it. It's a good, sturdy regia opal style sock yarn. I really like those because boy, do they last. I have socks that I knit 15, 20 years ago out of that stuff that is still kicking like I just knit it yesterday. I'm making these for my son. I think I'm gonna have a lot of yarn left. I'm at the heel. I just finished picking up the stitches for the gusset, and I still got tons of yarn left. I mean, that little area is what I've knit so far, and you can see how much more there is in there. So I think I might make him like some simple sleeveless mitts or something just to kind of use up some of the rest of the yarn. So that's been my kind of mindless knitting lately. I need to cast on another thinking project pretty soon. I think I've been avoiding that just because I really need to make that thinking project one of my own designs. Speaking of which, oh my gosh, I'm so excited to tell you about this. If you follow my blog at all, you already know this, or if you're on my Ravelry site, but I just confirmed that the release date for my first knitting book is September 15th. So all of the so I'm starting to tell people all about it. The book is called Kung Fu Knits, and I still love this idea, and I really like how it came out. It's basically a comic book slash pattern book, and the idea is, or the kind of the inspiration for it, is that it can be really hard to get boys to wear knits, right? I mean, I design a lot for boys. I have a son. I've knitted a lot for boys, and I understand, particularly with boys, just how hard it can be to get them to wear the stuff that we knit for them. And it has to do with a lot of things, right? I mean, it has to do with the fact that a lot of boys just aren't that interested in clothes. It has to do with the fact that males in general seem to run a higher body temperature than females in general. It has to do with style. Sweaters just aren't in style right now for boys. It's mostly sweatshirts, if they're going to wear anything at all. And freedom of movement is really a big thing. There aren't a lot of patterns for boys. There's just a lot of things kind of impeding that success story of I made something for this boy and he now really likes it and uses it all the time. So I was thinking a lot about that problem, like how to get around this and or how to deal with it. And I was thinking, if I wrote patterns in such a way and presented them in such a way that the kid on the other end thought they were so cool that they just really, really wanted it, then a lot of that other stuff might be mitigated. So basically the book is a comic book story at the front about a little boy who's, it's winter, he wants to go outside, it's really cold, his mom's like, you got to put all your boots and your coat and your hat and blah, blah, blah on. And he's like, oh, I don't want, it's not that cold. So not that I've ever heard this before, not that I've ever had this conversation before. Not that it gets that cold here, but anyway, it does sometimes. So his mom has basically made him this really cool kung fu stuff, and so kind of Calvin and Hobbes style in his head as he goes outside with all this stuff, it helps him defeat all these monsters that are out there. And then in the back are the patterns for the six things that are in the comic book story at the front. So there's a whole kung fu outfit. There's a jacket, pants, and belt. Those are the first three patterns. And then the latter three are kind of toys or accessories. So there's a bag that zips up, kind of backpack style bag. And then my two favorite things, knitted nunchucks and throwing stars or shurikens. Oh, so much fun to work on. So yeah, the book is it's Kung Fu Knits. It's coming out from Cooperative Press on September 15th. And right now, what I've got going on various social media is that if you post a picture, your favorite picture of a kid wearing something that you knitted or crocheted, you will be entered into a giveaway contest for a number of prizes. So, one of them is the sort of the grand prize is a signed paperback copy of the book, signed by me and the illustrator. And then, do I have it over here with me? No, I have it over here. I have this bag of Barocco Vintage, which is the yarn that I used for the pattern. Barocco very kindly let me give this to you all. So it's three skeins of the red and one of the white. It's enough to make a couple of the projects. And so that'll be the sort of the grand prize. There will be three separate digital copies of the book to give away. I ordered this adorable ninja project bag from someone on Etsy. Kicks and Giggles is the name of her shop, and then equally adorable ninja stitch markers from another shop on Etsy. And I don't have them yet. They're on their way, so I will show them to you when they come. But basically, post your picture now, between now and September 11th, which is a few days before the book comes out, and then I'll do drawings on September 12th for the prizes. You can post your picture once per social medium. So you can post it once on my Ravelry group. There's a thread there for it. Once on my Facebook page, the Dark Matter Knits page. Once on Pinterest, Twitter, and Instagram, once each there. And on Pinterest, Twitter, and Instagram, you want to use the hashtag Kung Fu Knits, just so I can find it. And people have already been posting photos. There's some really, really cute photos of everything from little babies to grown-up kids. You don't have to have kids of your own. It can be something that you've knit for somebody else's child. And your kids, if they are your kids, they don't have to be kids. If they're adult children of yours, that's fine too. That's enough about that. But I'm so excited. So let's get to the theme for this week. The theme for this week, yarn over. This actually started because I had a technique, have a technique that I want to show you at the end that has to do with yarn overs, and I was just trying to think more abstractly about yarn overs and what kind of how that might lead to some sort of broader discussion about knitting, and I was thinking about, like I said, the way that yarn overs can both either be a mistake or something that you do on purpose. And it kind of got me, it's something that I've been thinking a lot about the last, really the last month or so, is just when mistakes can be tolerated in knitting and when they can't. So here's the thing, is that I'm kind of I'm one of those people that if I see a small mistake in my knitting, I'm not going to rip back to fix it. If it's just knitting for me, or even if it's a gift for somebody else, and the mistake is not really that noticeable, it's staying. I don't care. I don't think little tiny things like that matter enough to fuss over. And that's kind of my general, I mean, I'm kind of like that in general. I mean, let me tell you, one of my favorite stories about my mother, I'm a lot like my mother in a lot of ways, which is a good thing. One of my favorite stories about her is that Oh, I think I've told you this story already. It's a story about how she took a test to see it was a they were in a whole group of officers and their wives. My dad used to be in the army. And it was when type A personality tests were the sort of the big thing. And so they all took this, are you a type A or type B personality test? And every single person in the room except for my mother was a type A, which of course you have to be if you're going to make it that far up the food chain in the army. And you're married to somebody, like all the responsibilities that you have to take on as the spouse of somebody who is working their way up the food chain, you kind of have to be a type A personality, except that my mom is not, and somehow she managed to kick it out of the park anyway. So the guy asked at the seminar, sorry, I'm just telling you the story all over again. If I have told it to you before, I apologize, but it's such a great story. So the guy comes back into the room and says, we've scored all the tests. Everybody was a type A personality except for one person in the room. And he looks at my mom, and there are hundreds of people in this room, looks at my mom and says, so Julie, how does it feel to be the one type B personality in this entire room? And my mom goes, yeah. That is my mom. Like that story is my mom. Like whole portions of her personality just captured so perfectly. God, she's funny. So I have some of that in me, the kind of meh mentality. And then there's my dad, who also is genetically in here, who is not like that. He is not a perfectionist, but he and he's not tightly wound or anything, but he's less likely to let things go, right? And he's ambitious. He's more ambitious, for good and ill, right? So I have both of those things in there. Now, the whole reason I bring this up is that the whole reason I got to thinking about this is that I got my teaching reviews back from a show that I taught at in the spring, from DFW Fiberfest. And they were abysmal. I mean, I have never gotten such terrible teaching reviews in my entire life. I was really devastated when I first read them, and now I have enough distance from it to put it in some perspective, which is kind of what I'm talking through here. And basically what I realized after I sort of got over the shock of it was that one of the things that I had done wrong was that I hadn't really realized how much more of a kind of upscale, not upscale, but just DFW Fiberfest has moved from being a very local show to being more of a regional show. The kind of thing, they bring in lots of national teachers, people come from a pretty good distance to come to this show. And so the expectations in the classroom are different. I tend to teach. When I have people in the room who are struggling, I have to stop and help them catch up. I generally do not do so to the exclusion of keeping everybody else moving, but I think I did a little too much of that at this in these classes. I had a few students who were really struggling in various ways. Partly because they shouldn't have signed up for the class in the first place. So some of that wasn't my fault, but I could have managed it a little better. And so I was just thinking about, I mean, one of the interesting lessons there is that, there's just a, when you move from doing something on a more amateur basis, like teaching classes informally or teaching classes at a more local level, to doing it more professionally, the expectations change. So, I'm fond of saying like it's just knitting, like don't freak out about it. But frankly, now that I'm a professional in the knitting industry, I kind of do have to, which goes against a lot of my grains. When I'm working on a knitting design, for example, and I'm knitting up the sample and notice a a mistake a few rows back. I have to go back and fix it. If I were just making it for myself or as a gift, I'd let it go. But I can't do that in a sample. I need to make sure that the instructions as written actually produce what they're supposed to. And I can't do that if I can't ensure that if I've made a mistake a few rows back. And so I guess I'm just, like, I'm really curious what you think about this as people who may have taken knitting and crochet classes, spinning classes, any kind of fiber related classes, what you most want out of those classes. What are the things you can't tolerate in the way that a class is structured or the way the teacher handles the classroom? And what do you most value? I'd be really, really interested to hear, especially as I'm sort of gearing up for my next big teaching experience at Arkansas Fiber Arts Extravaganza. I'd just be really interested in getting some more input on that from people who take classes. And similarly with knitting design, and even you know, purchasing yarn, just thinking through a little bit, like, how much imperfection can we tolerate? What kind of mistakes are too much in a pattern? How many knots, how many flaws are too much in yarn? And do we need to think about the circumstances under which that stuff is produced? You know, when we're talking about a hand dyer, do we give them more of a pass for knots when, you know, maybe you get some stuff from the mill that's just got some knots in it and you can't afford to scrap a few hundred yards of yarn? What are you going to do? I just think that's a really interesting conversation to have back and forth between people who are primarily consumers in the fiber industry and people who are primarily producers. People who are producers kind of for both, but, you know, what do you think? How many mistakes are too much when they're coming from people who are professionals in the industry? And I think this is part of why people who become professionals feel some regret, a little bit of regret about having lost that consumer side of things, because the kind of easy relationship that you have with knitting or crochet or spinning or whatever has to disappear to a certain extent. You can't make mistakes. You can't let that go. You've got to fix it up. So it takes a little bit of the fun out of it. Well, that was a downer. I don't really mean it to be. I just something that's kind of what this podcast is all about, is stuff I've been thinking about and trying to think of a way that it involves you in that conversation. So I'm going to open up a thread, as I always do, in the Ravelry group, in the Dark Matter Knits group, to continue this discussion. So I would welcome you to come over there and check it out. And I realized, having said that, that I haven't mentioned how to find me online. Usually do that at the beginning. But I'm at the main website is darkmatterknits.com, which is where you can find show notes for the podcast and a lot of other information. And there's a Dark Matter Knits group on Ravelry. I'm Elizabeth GM on Ravelry. And on Pinterest, not sure what I am on Pinterest. Don't really use it that much yet. I'm working on it. On Instagram and Twitter, I'm Dark Matter Knits. Okay, so let's move on to the technique tip. And I'm going to have to pause this for a second so I can get some yarn and some needles to show you this. Hang on. All right, so let's take a look at yarn overs, and just a simple little tip that I want to share with you about how to make your yarn overs look just a little fuller when you're actually doing them on purpose. So usually yarn overs are used in lace projects, and when you work lace, you know, you want those holes to be obvious. They're an essential part of the structure of the lace. So you really don't want them to close up too much. Now, some of that happens in the blocking. Some of that opening up of those holes happens when you stretch out, you know, wet down and stretch out the piece after it's finished. But you can help things along by working the yarn over in a particular way that keeps those holes nice and big. So I'll show you, the way I knit is continental, so I hold the yarn in my left hand. I'll show you that way first, since that's how I'm accustomed to doing things, and then I will show you how to do this if you're throwing. So a yarn over, if you're knitting, you've got the yarn in the back, and you're just going to move the yarn to the front and over the top of the needle back to the back. And that's the yarn over right there. It creates an extra loop that wasn't there before, and it will create a hole in your knitting. Now, the next thing you would do is then go on to make whatever the next stitch is. In this case, I'll just make it a knit, and you could just go on from there. But the problem is that, particularly if you're a tight knitter, if you yank on that too much, that yarn over is going to be pretty small. It's going to tighten up quite a bit. So what I do when I'm doing a yarn over is I go ahead and make the yarn over, and then I just put my pointer finger there and see how I'm kind of holding the yarn in such a way that the yarn over stays, like the yarn's not going anywhere. It's not going to tighten up too much. And I just keep that pointer finger there as I work the next stitch. And, you know, it's hard to tell from here, but just believe me when I say that this is a lot looser. In fact, you probably can see there's quite a bit more of a hole under there. So it just makes it easier to open up that lace later. Now, if you're a thrower and have the yarn, say, as many people do, wrapped around your pointer finger, it's not something you can't necessarily hold the yarn down with your finger as you continue working. But what I would do is this, just make sure, actually you kind of can now that I try this. As you work the next stitch, just hold this down. Oh no, that's not gonna work. But as you wrap, I guess what I would say in that case is just keep it super loose. In fact, if you're accustomed to tightening that next stitch, don't do it. Just kind of take a moment to stop and not yank on that stitch right after the yarn over so that you again get a nice big hole underneath. There we go. Sorry, the camera's having trouble focusing here. So that's my tip for keeping yarn overs loose, is just to use either your pointer finger if you're knitting continental to hold that yarn in place while you work the next stitch, or just work the next stitch very loosely if you're a thrower. I also just thought I'd show you, as long as we're talking about yarn overs, what a double yarn over looks like. Sometimes you'll see in a chart, say, YO2 or a very big circle, or there are all kinds of ways of designating this, or instructions, it might be YO2 or YO twice. And basically what that means is, again, let's say you're knitting, you literally want to do a yarn over once and then swing around again. So you've gone back to front to back to front to back. You've now got two wraps around the needle. And then you continue on. Again, I'll make that next stitch really loose. The problem is, what happens when you come back to that stitch? It will depend on the pattern. Some patterns will have you, in fact, you know what, I'm going to do another one down here at the end so I can get back to it more quickly. Some patterns will have you use a yarn over twice as an increase to, as an invisible increase, and some of them are using it to make a very, very big hole. So let me show you what that looks like. Oops, forgot to do a yarn over. Okay, so I'm going to do a couple of them here so I can show you both kinds. Okay, so I'll yarn over twice. Move along a little bit. Yarn over twice. And get to the end. Now it's on the next row that you actually have to do something with that yarn over twice. And it's a little bit different from just encountering a regular yarn over, because a regular yarn over you can just treat like a stitch. But what happens when you've got two loops. See, I just pulled it off. Now I've got two loops on the needle. If I just try to work it, I can't. I just worked the first part and I can't just purl the next part because there's nothing, like I can't get into it without the yarn doing weird things. So typically what a pattern is going to have you do, let me back up a second and put the yarn over back. So there's my double yarn over. What you would probably do in this case is something like this. Purl into the front, put the yarn to the back, and knit the other half. Oh my goodness, I am struggling with this right now. There we go. It's really hard to do this looking through a camera. And what that does is, look, it leaves a giant hole. And actually, I should say, this is pretty much exactly what happens with a double yarn over. That's typically what you're going to do. The other thing you might do is just, sometimes instructions will tell you just to purl into that front loop and then just let the back loop drop off. And again, you've got a giant hole, but now you've only increased by one stitch. So basically, you'll get a giant hole either way with a double yarn over, but you've either increased by two stitches or you've increased by one stitch. And this is used just for decorative effect, to make bigger holes in some places. It just makes a nice variation on the usual yarn over. So there's some tips about yarn overs.